We'll continue with the talk on encryption, end-to-end cloud encryption. I'm happy that we have Christian and Markus from Schmickler with us this afternoon.
Yes, thank you very much. Can you hear me? Am I online, kind of? Okay, great. My name is Christian Schmickler, and this is my colleague Markus Kreusch. We have just arrived from, well, myself from Bonn, which we found, or where we founded Schmickler in November last year. Markus is from Stuttgart, and we have been around with Cryptomator, our cloud-optimized encryption software, for about 1 year. The software has been in development a little bit longer. Markus is going to tell you a lot of details and also about the technology of Cryptomator in the second part of this talk. And in the first part, I would like to talk about our motivation. I'm not a technician. My background...
Sorry, brief interruption. I think your microphone is not turned on.
It is not turned on. Okay. Did you understand a little bit of what I said? Oh, here we go.
Yeah, now.
Thank you. Okay. Do I have to repeat anything or did you get everything? Top? Yes. Okay, thank you. Well, Christian Schmickler, Markus Kreusch, Bonn, Germany, and Stuttgart, and just for the summary. Yes, and well, about our motivation to follow the Cryptomator project and now to have founded Schmickler. And this is to empower everyone to protect their privacy by themselves, not only IT specialists, but everyone, because we regard privacy as something very important. And this brings us to the first heading, privacy and informational self-determination. Right now, we are living in this ongoing process of digital transformation or digitalization, and in the private and in the corporate world. And at the same time, it seems that digitalization and privacy and informational self-determination do not go very well along with one another. We are working on better solutions, yes, but like in the perception of many people, it does not seem to be really the case. And it's not paranoia that we think, okay, we mistrust many services, but if we just look at some privacy policies, we can actually read and we have a valid proof why we do have a bad feeling in the very moment we use the internet if we are concerned with our privacy. Well, the skepticism really started with the big media coverage after the Snowden NSA affair in 2013. This is when it really took off, the disclosures, the safe harbor privacy principles. They were criticized a lot by Maximilian Schrems, this Austrian journalist and lawyer, which should be mentioned because we are in Vienna today. I don't know actually where he is from, probably not from Vienna, but at least he from here actually. Okay, so. Greetings to him, perhaps. And well, he initiated the lawsuit that led to the European Court of Justice discontinuing the safe harbor privacy principles in 2015. And then in February 2016, the European Commission initiated the EU-US privacy shield, which was directly again criticized and which probably will not last for eternity. And it is also fair to say, or it's my personal speculation, that the Trump legislation is not going to do too much to increase the trust we have in privacy in services from the US, probably. It is just my guess, but we will see the way it's going to develop. The thing is that governments, they have a valid concern. They can say, okay, we actually need surveillance and lack of privacy among the people in order to ensure internal security of a state, okay? We can doubt whether or not this is actually the case. If the political agenda is set right, there may be some arguments for that. But at the same time, we have those private corporations that have made surveillance as their primary business model. And there's a huge difference between those two things, because a private corporation is by definition not subject to control by any democratic entity, which intelligence agency at least supposed to be are. Here it is a matter of political willpower, whether or not they are handled with transparency and with integrity. Even though the business model, I think, is really problematic, we all contribute our data to make those models work. We allow our apps, we all know those windows, particularly in this room, we all allow our apps to access our private data. And while it may be vital for an app to have actual access to those data, it is not too vital to have privacy policies like this one. It is from WhatsApp. I think it is even stated in the first line there. You provide us the phone numbers of WhatsApp users and your other contacts in your mobile phone address book on a regular basis, and you confirm that you are authorized to provide us such numbers. That means that if you agree, or if you confirm this, then you also confirm that you have the active consent by all the people you have stored in your address book, that they are fine with you sharing their data with WhatsApp, which is called consent by third parties. And obviously nobody has it, but everybody agrees to those privacy rules. So this just for an example. And everything I've said so far does not include illegal activities by hackers if personal information data for logins is lost, and all these things we also read. Well, the thing is, if we... So, here we go. If we use services that agree to those privacy policies, we just make surveillance very easy and very cheap. Perhaps too easy and too cheap. And it is very interesting that we do that, because if we ask people, we will see that there's a huge desire for informational self-determination, and actually 84% of the people, and I think people in 12 industrialized countries have been asked here, they say that they are not okay if information about themselves or their behavior is shared with any third parties without the user's active consent. So the question is, okay, if 84% say, yes, we're not okay with it, but we still use the service, I would pose the question, have we all gone mad? Or what is wrong here? Why does our behavior not match our attitude? And the phenomenon, of course, is called the privacy paradox. And the question is, why does this paradox exist? And we have tried to find, to just show or illustrate some of the reasons, just to have them, to grasp them once. And the thing is, the first point is, of course, network effects. If a service is used by many people, its value increases exponentially, because there are more and more connections between the people. And then it is almost a social coercion, a kind of social force to also use a service such as Facebook, WhatsApp, because otherwise you are the odd man out. And who can afford to be the green circle here, to be the odd man out? Sometimes it's even a vocation necessity. Everybody knows it. A colleague asks you, can I send something to you via WhatsApp? You will have to install WhatsApp. You will have to agree to those terms I just read out before. And we have the dilemma. So another point is that sharing is just fun. We are communicators as human beings. And there's an interesting study that shows that in the very moment a person shares personal information in a social network, such as Facebook, we experience joy, even if this information has not been received, not read, not seen by any of our contacts or friends for whom we have shared it. It's just the very process of sharing already makes us feel joyful for some reason, but it's just the way our psyche works. And which is not fun is reading privacy policies, because they're usually long, they are not easy to understand, particularly they are a demotivator when you find the important bits on page 8 somewhere down in the small print, and nobody really wants to read them. So we just agree to those without having read them. And that's interesting, because being in the digital realm, in the digital world, seems to be an atypical way of interaction. And the thing is, that when we move around in the normal world, in the physical world, we would encounter new things and we would be cautious. We would have a cautious attitude to those things, and this does not seem to hold true in the digital realm. If we have a contract printed out and presented in front of you, you would not just sign it without even having read at least the most important bits of it. And this is kind of strange, and we have asked, why is that we are so careless in the digital realm? And the first reason is probably that those cautionary instincts that govern our lives in the normal world, in the physical world, is that they are linked to our physical presence. So if you're not there, you cannot be harmed. This might be the underlying assumption there. The second thing is perceived anonymity, of course. If you are in the digital realm, then you're at home, and you seem to hide behind your device. And then we have familiar device. The question is, who has not been in bed with their smartphone? Yeah, okay, it's a little bit perhaps a funny question, but it is like a best friend, because our smartphone connects us with our family, our friends, and everybody, and it's a very familiar device, and this is why we may not see the danger that is really behind that. Well, of course, I cannot speak for this audience here, but I can speak for the normal, for the people out there who are not directly concerned with security. And the fourth reason here is that we don't have a surface feel, that we don't have any haptic, that every click feels the same, whether or not we just send an email, or whether we just sign an important contract, or agree to certain, and for us, important terms and conditions, general conditions, for instance. And then, of course, we have those swarm effects, and so a swarm behavior or herd instinct, and that says just that everybody uses a service, so it cannot be that harmful, which may be a wrong assumption, of course. And unfortunately, many people still claim that they had nothing to hide, and also here we can ask the question, why is that? And the answer here is probably because the damage of missing privacy is not that obvious. Because, as a matter of fact, it is hard to grasp the harm or the damage that may be done. It will occur only in the future, while I have the utility and the fun of using a certain service right now, the potential harm is in the future, and it will only occur potentially, well, potential harm, of course, because I don't know whether or not I will be, have a disadvantage or not. So, because we think that it's important to have dealt or to have explicitly talked about the most important consequences of missing privacy, I think I just want to point them out quickly before we come to Cryptomator then. The first one is self-censorship, because surveillance will create or does create a prison in our mind, and it's already enough to have the perception of self-censorship. And creativity and exploration and just playing around, trying to get to new ideas, we need to have a free space where we don't feel watched, where we don't feel judged by anyone else. And perhaps we all know it, if you use a Google Docs document, which I would not directly recommend, but if you do it and you see that somebody else is also working on the same document, and you may, and the other person may just read all the things that you're just writing, you're just having a brainstorming session for yourself, you may already feel restricted and may not work as freely as you do. The same holds probably true if you write an exam at university and some supervisor comes to your side and you exactly know that he's looking at your paper, he or she is looking at what you're just writing. It may just not feel good and you may act less creatively than you would otherwise. The second point is classification, which is very close to discrimination. Due to the conclusions drawn from data that a person has published, for instance, in social medias, he or she can be discriminated against. And the conclusions are usually of probabilistic nature, so there may be classifications. For instance, in Germany, I don't know who is from Germany who has heard of the Schufa, which is an institution that rates the solvency of different individuals. And if you just live in the wrong street with people of a rather low solvency, then you will have a lower Schufa score, it is called, and then you will probably pay more interest for a loan that you take. Another example would be a startup also from Germany. I should probably not mention the name. So what they do is they have developed an algorithm that collects all the personal data from all the social networks of one individual, and then they calculate a score with which likelihood a person is willing to change jobs. And they rent or they license this algorithm to headhunters, for instance, for job search. This sounds pretty nice, but if a HR department of a company uses this tool to analyze their own staff, and Mrs. X or Mr. Y, they have a likelihood like of 80% of wanting to change jobs, then the question, and this may be a misclassification, or the score might be way lower, what does it mean for a company culture if you think, okay, Mrs. X is probably wanting to leave us in the near future, and what does it mean for the climate in a company? I think we will have to ask those questions when we want to evaluate whether or not such a solution is actually a good thing. Well, then, of course, the next thing is manipulability. We all know that advertisements and contents are already customized and presented to us. And we get those contents that algorithms think that we are interested in, but they can also select contents and charge them with an emotional valence that they kind of know that will draw our interest. So if I'm very interested in horses, I may get I'm actually not that interested in horses, but just assume that I am interested in horses, then I may get very nice horse pictures with certain political messages, and then we come back to the discussion whether or not like social bots and those kind of social media manipulation mechanisms may even help decide political elections, or perhaps not. And examples here would be ranking of the Google results and news feed at Facebook. And the last thing, and I think this is very important, is the presumption of innocence. If in a society everybody says that they do not care for their privacy and everybody says they had nothing to hide, then those people who still claim they do have something to hide or at least value their privacy, perhaps for the very good reasons, those people become suspicious. They don't get suspicious, but they may be assumed to be not innocent in the way. I think you get what I mean. This may be important for journalists, for activists, or for researchers also, that ask questions that are inconvenient about the status quo, for instance. And with political developments in certain countries, I think it is very important that also in the future activists will have their voice and will have the ability to raise their voice, for which they will probably need privacy. So at this point, it becomes very obvious, and this is my last slide, that privacy and data security are a collective challenge which cannot be solved by one individual only. If I want to encrypt my data and I install a PGP or SMIME key and nobody of my contacts does it, it really does not help me because I will the odd man out here, the green one again. And if I do not have apps, or if I don't allow apps to have permissions to access my address book, and all of my friends, of my networks do it, it is not really effective because the numbers get to WhatsApp and all the other services anyway. So we can only solve that all together. So it is the responsibility and the mission of all the end users to know that they make decisions not only for themselves, but also for the people around them, for the collective good. And it is also the mission of developers to develop software that is secure and that can be used by everyone and still protecting their privacy. One of those developers is Markus Kreusch because he develops Cryptomator, this cloud-optimized encryption software that is also open source. So we have this this transparency in our idea. And I will end with that and hand it over to Markus. Thank you very much.
Okay. Is this on? Yeah, okay. So Christian so far explained you privacy issues in general. He explained to you why we all have to work together to solve those issues, and he also told you why this is relevant for the cloud. And we will now present one tool to enhance privacy in the cloud. Okay. This is Cryptomator. Okay. Cryptomator is a tool for usable, open source, end-to-end cloud storage encryption. And Cryptomator means privacy, usability, and open source for the cloud. I'll explain to you now what those aspects mean in the context of Cryptomator. First is privacy. Privacy means that cloud data can only be read by the one who placed it there. We use end-to-end encryption to ensure this. And this, on the one hand, prevents the cloud provider from getting any access to the data, and in addition also prevents that any third parties who may intercept network traffic or hack into networks, etc., can access the data. In addition, the protection of the data gets independent of security measures taken by the cloud provider. Another point regarding privacy is so-called true zero-knowledge encryption, which in this context means that we do not only want to have no access to user data, passwords, keys, etc., but we also do not want to grab any additional usage information. So Cryptomator is designed to work only locally. There's no requirement to log into our servers. Keys are stored locally, and every data transfer is done through the cloud. And the only thing we actually do is an update check, which can even be disabled by the user. The next point on the list is usability. When you use encryption software, you always have the need to do some more work. You have to getting to know it, you have to install it, you have maybe to configure it, enter passwords, activate it, etc. And to allow a broad distribution of the software, we want to reduce the effort the user has to take to the minimum possible. So we want a UI that is as simple as possible and can be used intuitively. In addition, for an average user, we do not require any crypto knowledge, which means if the user had to select a crypto algorithm, that would be too much. We don't want that the user has to do that. The last point is this overall design leads to a simpler system and a simpler design, which can be easily understood by a user. And if it is easily understood, attacks like social engineering get much harder. One example for this is that we may choose only password and synchronous encryption instead of async encryption methods because public-private key sharing, etc., is more complex and harder to explain to the user. The next point is open source. Our desktop application and our crypto libraries are open sourced. We chose AGPL version 3 because this, on the one hand, allows us to be transparent and allows us to publish our source code, and on the other hand, still allows commercial licensing of our software. Open source code is read by people interested in cryptography, and our code is read by people interested in Cryptomator, which is in effect like a permanent code review. In addition, open source code allows, it makes it really hard to implement backdoors into an application and does not allow to keep security issues secret. In this way, you can say that open source creates trustability. In addition to open sourcing our code, we publish our encryption scheme, keep it updated on our website, and we do public issue tracking and release planning on GitHub. That's just basically at the moment, but we want to extend it further in the future. This is a short overview over the history of the project. Cryptomator was initiated in February 2014, and it followed a phase of around 2 years of beta development, which involved many feedback from the community. It took that long because the project, the developers of the project only worked in their free time, so during studies and side jobs, and didn't invest full time into the project. That changed in March 2016 when version 1.0 was released, and Cryptomator got awarded with the CeBIT Innovation Award for Usable Security and Privacy. We then launched an Android beta release in October 2016, formed a legal entity Schematic, and extracted our crypto libraries into separate projects. And those libraries are already used by two other products, namely CyberDuck, which is a remote file access software supporting protocols like FTP or WebDAV, and a PowerFolder, which is a German cloud provider. In general, Cryptomator supports desktop and mobile operating systems. Currently, we support Windows, macOS, and Linux. And on the mobile market, we have iOS available, which was released with our main application in March 2016, and Android in beta state. I'll now show you a little about how the Cryptomator desktop application works to just lead to some general understanding. And afterwards, we'll come to the mobile application. In Cryptomator, you create so-called vaults, and each vault is protected by a password. In general, you can choose where your vault is stored, so you can choose the location you want the encrypted data to reside, and you can unlock a vault. When unlocked, a vault is mounted as a drive, virtual drive on your computer, and you can access the clear text data. This is in general the same as other tools for this encryption, for example, work. The difference is that we keep each file encrypted separately, which leads to better synchronization. And if this encrypted data is stored in the cloud, then you in effect have cloud storage encryption. There are some challenges targeting the cloud, so why can you just use a tool like VeraCrypt to do that? One thing is efficient syncing, because if you have a big VeraCrypt container, which is basically a single file then a single bit or a single byte change may lead to full synchronization. There are cloud services which support partial synchronization, but not all, and our target is to support most cloud services, so you have to keep syncing in mind. You can't sync a complete container file each time you change a little data. The second point is no single source of truth. When you use conventional disk encryption or encryption software, then you always know everything written to it and everything read from it passes through your code on this device, because you operate only locally. As soon as the cloud kicks in, it can be that you use another device earlier that day, you turn on your computer, mount the drive, and then cloud synchronization kicks in and changes the files. If you develop a system for clouds which encrypts data, you have to think about this. The third point is mobile access scenarios. On mobile devices, you have limited storage available, so you in general cannot sync the full cloud to your local device. And in this case, you have to think about some usage scenarios like streaming of videos or audio data, or you have to think about, in effect, minimizing the communication required between the cloud and the local device. So this is some screens from our Android application. Basically, we can add and create vaults as you can do on a desktop application. Currently, we only support Dropbox and Google Drive, but more will follow in the future. And we have a basic file browser available. So in general, you can list your files, browse your files, add, upload, download, delete, move, rename, etc. your files, and do some basic enhanced functionality like sharing. Some additional things we want to do before we release 1.0 is, on the one hand, background up and download. Currently, it's a little bit weird because you have to let the application in the state while uploading. So there's a dialog which pops up, which you cannot close, which shows you the upload progress. That's not what we want. We want to have it to be done in the upload, as the normal cloud service apps do. We want to add document providers so you can have more native look, native feeling while using the application. So as many cloud providers do, you will have a document provider to integrate into your operating system for unlocked vaults. Then auto-lock feature, which is required if we have this, because then a vault would keep open when you close the app. And to prevent that the vault stays open indefinite time, we have to lock it somehow. So after a certain timeout or when you lock your device, etc. And in addition, of course, some maybe the most important features, addition of more cloud services. Currently, we plan to support OneDrive and WebDAV protocol, and there are additional plans, for example, to provide local vaults, which would allow to synchronize through a third-party app installed, which synchronizes from the local file system, or to support additional protocols like FTP. So this is a short overview over the architecture, so how we connect to clouds. In general, it's a really basic thing here. You see software components, you see implements relationships and users relationships. We have our model view presenter UI, which does async calls against our cloud API. Then for each cloud, we implement a separate adapter. This API is, you can think of it as the set union of the operations supported by all providers. And so the UI doesn't have to care about which provider we are talking to. And in addition, there's our encryption decorator. This decorator, on the one hand, acts as cloud API by itself, so can be used directly by the UI. And in addition, it uses the cloud API to store the encrypted data. So encryption happens here, and encrypted data is then transferred to one of the cloud services. So we don't have to attach the crypto code to add additional providers. Yet some details about our encryption scheme. It's just some basic information. You can find more on our webpage. The link is on the next slide, I think. We do key derivation from the user's password. We generate 256 byte keys for encryption and MAC computation. We use one passphrase per vault, mentioned before. And we use Ascrypt to harden for key derivation, so to prevent brute forcing of the keys, and do key wrapping using the key derived from the password as key encrypting key. The next thing is name encryption. We use AES and ZIF mode for name encryption, And we do base 32 encoding of the encrypted filenames, which in effect makes longer filenames, but is required to, on the one hand, allow us to support clouds which are case insensitive, or file systems which are case insensitive, and on the other hand, this is required to don't have some meta characters or special characters, slashes, etc. in the filenames. The next point is content encryption. This is just a short overview. I'll have a slide afterwards which explains this in some more detail. Then path shortening and structure obfuscation. That's not really a security feature, but more like a compatibility layer, because due to base32 encoding, we get really long paths and really long filenames, and we have to shorten them somehow to allow that some operating systems still work, because there are limits on the filename length or on the complete path length. So on the one hand, we shorten paths longer than 255 characters, which means we create a thing like a symlink for those files and store the name in the file. And the other thing is that we do not nest directories, but all encrypted directories, even if nested in the in decrypted data, are placed alongside each other in the cloud. This slide shows the file content encryption with some more detail. In general, you can look for more details on this and the full description on our website. And when encrypting file contents, we take the clear text file content and split it into equally sized chunks. It is we currently use 32 kilobyte chunks. We then run it through AES CTR, so in counter mode, using a randomly generated nonce, random per each chunk, and a content key which is generated per file. This encrypted data is then used to compute an HMAC using the MAC key, which is generated per vault. We use the header nonce, chunk number, and nonce value generated here to compute this HMAC value. The header nonce is used to bind the block to the file, and the chunk number is used to prevent reordering. This data is then joined together and forms the new ciphertext file content. As mentioned before, more details can be found here. So I'm approaching the end of my presentation. I'll just give you some overview of our future plans we have with Cryptomator. On the one hand, we plan Cryptomator for Business. Cryptomator for Business in general is a version of Cryptomator which includes key management and user management, so some features required by companies, which shall be available as on-premise software or as software as a service. And we currently intend to do a licensing model per user and month, but it's not all that fixed yet. Then we want to do Fuse and Doken integration. Actually, we currently mount the virtual drive using WebDAV, which is a good choice if you want to get OS support on all operating systems quick, but has some implications regarding performance and has some limits on some operating systems. So we want to provide the virtual drive using Fuse on Linux and macOS, and using Doken on Windows. Then that's kind of a long-term plan, and we did not yet decide if we will do that, but we want, of course, to support as many clouds as possible. And one thing we could do on Android is, for example, to allow document provider integration so that you can store the encrypted data using a document provider. And the other thing is that we could open source our cloud API too, and this will allow to integrate third-party implementations of cloud services. Okay, in general, that's what I have to tell you about Cryptomator today. If you have any questions or ideas concerning this project, just tell us. Here's some basic contact information. And if you want to support us, you can like us on Facebook, and especially visit us and look at our code on GitHub, comment us to us, send open issues if you have any ideas, and stars. Thank you.
Questions?
Hi, thanks for a nice presentation. Maybe I missed something, just wondering. You're using CTR
yes.
to encrypt the file contents, but you're also doing some sort of chunking or breaking into pieces.
Yes.
Why use CTR while you're breaking into blocks? Or
why we do that?
Well, CTR is, streaming
Yes, sort yes. And we break it into chunks because we have to compute, so we authenticate each chunk separately. So we can see if it is, we can check the authenticity of a chunk of 32 kilobytes instead of having to read the full data and authenticate the full file at once. So for example, for streaming, this is required to allow that you can read part of the file, start of the file, for example, and authenticate that.
Okay, so it's for performance.
Yeah.
So what is the difference between this software like TrueCrypt or VeraCrypt and yours approach?
Basically, it's optimized for the cloud scenario. So we have these problems I mentioned before regarding the cloud in mind. So for example, we separate files separately. So we do not create a single container file. But if you encrypt four files, you have four encrypted files on your drive. Of course, this leaks some information. So for example, it's still visible how many files you have, and the file sizes are visible. But the contents per se are encrypted. So it enhances privacy to a degree, which still keeps some important features the user really wants to use the cloud.
Name of the files?
Sorry?
Did you reveal the name of the files?
No, the file names are encrypted.
Yes. Thank you.
Did you consider something like proxy re-encryption, where you can encrypt data with our key in the cloud without having to download it again?
No, not so far. Really, I'm not so that into crypto so that I can exactly tell you. But we didn't think about such things yet.
I was wondering, how are you verifying that your crypto actually works?
How are we verifying? Okay, so you are talking about our implementation, or?
Yes, the implementation.
Okay, we use, so Cryptomator is in general Java-based, and we use do not implement crypto by ourselves, but we use the algorithms provided by Java to us, so we don't have to verify the algorithms because we do not write them by ourselves. And our implementation, of course, is currently public, and we got feedback from many, many people regarding cryptography. We already did some security fixes in the beta phase, and regarding Cryptomator for Business, we are targeting auditing of our code, so it will improve security. And something I may add in this case is, for example, we implemented, for example, ZIF mode by ourselves, so we use in basically Java basic cryptography primitives from Java, but we implemented ZIF mode because that didn't exist for Java, but this part of our code has already been reviewed by a company who integrated it.
So I'm just wondering if you could, I don't think you mentioned the how the syncing works, so I'm guessing that's like part of the chunking is when a chunk changes, you only sync that.
No, actually, the chunks are only for, for example, for streaming efficiency, and are joined back together as a single file. So in general, syncing works the same way it worked before. So that's some of the principles. We don't want to modify the behavior of the cloud in any way, but one file is one encrypted file, and if the cloud sees a change in this file, it is synced, but it's not done by our application in the desktop case. But yeah, the encrypted files are placed in a directory on your computer, and the synchronization software of the cloud provider performs synchronization. On the mobile devices, we have to integrate cloud providers by ourselves, because there you do not want to sync the complete data locally. So we have to make separate calls to the cloud provider's API for each request, for each file, or et cetera. And we have some code in our application which handles synchronization conflicts. So for example, you modify a file at the same time on two devices, then in general, most cloud providers create two files. The one is then called in brackets two afterwards, and we handle such things. And if you see the start of the file name is an encrypted file name and it's valid and it's authenticated, then we can just present to the user two decrypted files with the same name pattern.
So if I have, say, a 5 gigabyte file, I change 1 byte, it's not going to sync 5 gigabytes.
The syncing in general works as it would work if when it would not be encrypted. So if the cloud would sync a complete big file through a single bit change or single byte change, then this would also happen when it is encrypted.
Okay, thanks for the presentation.